Hey there, Josh Powers with Quixel. And in today's video, we're going to dive into the functionality of the MaskStack's powerful curvature component and how it can be utilized to add wear and detail to your texture. So let's get started. In short, the curvature component acts the same way a curvature map will, but it's done in real time so that it can take into account all of the layers of your mix. So let's go ahead and activate this simple solid layer and we'll add a mask stack. We can find the curvature option under the component button at the top of the mask stack. Now if we go to mask mode by hitting 9 on the keyboard, we can see that our mask looks very similar to what a curvature map on this model might look like. And over here on the right, we have several settings that will let us adjust the look of the curvature. Let's start off by looking at this dropdown here that is currently set to default curvature. The default curvature setting will essentially give you a standard looking curvature based on the mesh and normal data. The brighter pixels being more of the peaks and edges, and the darker pixels being more of the crevices and cavity details. And then the mid-gray tones being more of a flat open area. Basically, this should look very similar to the results you would get from baking a curvature map from a high-poly mesh. The next option is edges only, and this will cause the mask to only reveal edges or convexities of the mesh and normal map. Using this setting is a great way to quickly isolate edges on your texture. After that is cavities only. And as you probably guessed, this will create a mask based on the cavities of the mesh in normal map. And then edges and cavities will take both of these settings and add them together so that your mask will utilize both convex and concave details. Alright, below this we have another dropdown. And this dropdown determines what data is used to generate the curvature map. The settings are underlying mix, base normals, current layer, mesh only, and base curvature map. The first and default setting is underlying mix. This setting will base the curvature information on all the layers below this one. So if I activate this flaking solid layer beneath, you'll see right away that the flakes get picked up by the component. Because I typically want my mask to be affected by all the layers beneath, I almost always leave this setting at default. The next setting is base normals. When I select it, you'll see that the details from the flaking solid layer get removed from the mask. And that's because this setting uses the mesh, normal, and curvature information from the base layer settings. This can be really useful when you've added a lot of smaller textural detail to your mix that you don't necessarily want coming through, but you do want the broader detail of the original mesh and normal map to show. We'll come back to current layer in a moment, and we'll move to mesh only first. Mesh only will utilize the geometry of your mesh exclusively to get the curvature information. It ignores normal map, height map, and curvature map data, and just relies on the mesh itself. It does look a little strange, but there are some uses for it, especially to get some cool and stylized shading for your textures. So feel free to play around with this and see what you get. Now if I go back up to current layer, you'll notice that the results look identical to mesh only. And that's because there's no normal or height data on this layer because it's simply a solid color layer. So it's going to just pick up on the mesh. However, if I turn on this layer up here, which is using a Megascan surface, and go into its mask stack, I can select the current layer setting in the curvature component, and right away you can see how the mask is using the normal and height data from the Megascan surface to create the curvature mask. So this is a really great way of utilizing this setting. Then lastly is base curvature map, which will use the curvature map itself that's used in the base material. Below the dropdown, we have two slider panels. The tightness slider controls the number of edges sampled, and as I slide this value up, you'll start to lose that broader contrast and the details become pretty small, giving it something of a high pass effect. The other slider is levels, and this operates like a levels adjustment in any other program. Pull the left slider handle to bring out the darker pixels, and the right slider handle to bring out the brighter pixels. And then you can pull them both close together in the middle for a strong contrasting mask. Next, we have a few checkboxes down at the bottom. Anti-aliasing will help minimize artifacts and distortion that we might get when working from a source image that's larger than our canvas resolution. For example, this asset's source textures are at 8K, but my working resolution is only 2K. In this case, the effects are virtually unnoticeable, but this option is there for you if you're seeing some artifacts such as jagged lines. Next to that, we have soft mesh. And this option will attempt to reduce some of the harder triangulated edges of the mesh to give a softer appearance to the mask. And then lastly is invert. Invert is an option on all the mask components, and it will simply let you invert your results. Now that we know how curvature works, let's put it to some use on a few quick examples. Here we have an old coin, and it's in pretty good shape for its age. So let's activate this solid layer above it so we can give it some oxidization, which we can do very quickly using the curvature component. First, we'll go into mask mode, again by pressing 9 on the keyboard, and then we'll set the top drop down to edges and cavities, which will utilize both the edges and cavities for the mask. And then by simply adjusting the levels, mostly bringing the right slider down, we are able to add this cool greenish oxidizing look to the coin. One of the most common uses for the curvature component is to give some wear and tear to the edges of an asset. So let's give this metal box a bit of a darkness near the edges to make it feel as if the paint and finish has worn off over the years. This process is virtually the same as the one I just showed you, except instead of using both edges and cavities, we'll use edges only. Then we'll adjust the levels to the desired range that fits the look we're going for, and there we go, we've quickly added some edge wear to this box. This process is also a very common way to expose some raw metal on the edges of props such as guns and armor. With the new 3D texturing feature inside Mixer, many of our tutorials have been focused on that lately. However, for the most part, everything we cover in these tutorials will function with tiling mixes as well. So let's take a moment and add some color detail to this tiling rock formation. We'll activate the solid blue layer here, give it a mask stack, and add a curvature component. We'll leave everything at default, except that I will bring in both of the level slider handles a little bit. Doing this gave us a bit of a bluish hue to the surface of the rock, which adds some nice color breakup. Next, we'll add some highlights to the edges. We'll activate this layer above, and then as before, we'll apply a curvature mask component. Now we could just use the edges only feature to start off, however we'll achieve the look we're going for by simply adjusting the levels, pushing the slider handles together on the high end of the slider. There we go, now we have some lighter highlights towards the edges of some of these jagged cuts in the rock. Lastly, we'll add a bit of dirt into the crevices. After activating the solid layer and adding a curvature component to the mask stack, we'll change the top drop down to cavities only, and then all we'll need to do is lower the right slider handle down a good bit to reveal some of the dirt in these cracks and crevices of the texture. And there you go. So I hope you are able to get a better understanding of how the curvature mask component works and how it can be a big help to taking your textures to the next level. Check back tomorrow for the next video in the series to learn even more about the tools within the mask stack. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.